January 501 here. I'm in the American Meteor Society, and here's a resource for the major meteor showers. The meteor showers discussed below reoccur each year. In some cases, they have been recognized for hundreds of years. The name of the shower, in most cases, indicates the constellation from which the meteors appear. Also discussed are sporadic rates. Sporadic meteors are those random meteors not associated with a particular shower. They are the random detritus left over from the creation of the solar system, or are old dispersed debris not recognizable today as a meteor shower or meteor. Click on the shower names when linked for more detail on any given shower. For meteor observers, those located in the northern hemisphere have a distinct advantage as shower activity is stronger there than that seen by observers located south of the equator. The reason for this is that most of the major showers have been meteors that strike the Earth in areas located far above the equator. As seen from the northern hemisphere, these meteors would appear to rain down from high in the sky in all directions. From those situated in the southern hemisphere, only a small percentage of this activity is visible. Any activity would appear to travel upwards from radiance located low in the sky. There are a few meteor showers best seen from the southern hemisphere. These would include any radiant with a declination celestial latitude below minus 20, and those that reach maximum activity during the southern hemisphere's winter months, July, August, September. These showers would include the Alpha Centaurids, Gamma Normids, Pi Puppids, Pisces Astronids, Delta Aquarids, Alpha Capricornids, Dec Phinacids, and Puppid Velids. That was a mouthful. The year begins with the intense but brief quadrantid maximum January 3 through 4. Then there were some in March, April, May, June, July, August. August was the Perseid maximum. And the high sporadic activity after midnight continues for the rest of the year. But especially in September and the first half of December, sporadic rates over 20 an hour are possible for this entire interval. September radiants are numerous in Aries and Taurus. Mid-October to mid-December is a nearly continuous period of heavy meteor activity. The Orionids max October 21st and 22nd. During the second half of October, have a prolonged plateau maximum for several nights, usually rich. The Taurids max October 11th for South Taurids and November 13 and 14 for North Taurids, active for 2 months, are most numerous in November's first half and can be rather variable in strength. This period is the best for a couple of Taurid fireballs each night if the shower is not too weak. The Leonids of mid-November, max November 17th and 19th, are quite unpredictable, with rich displays occurring roughly every 33 years. The last Leonid storm period occurred from 1998 through 2002. Studies have shown that no Leonid storms will occur in either 2033 or 2066. We will have to wait until 2099 for a return of the activity recently seen during the past few years. This doesn't mean Leonid Elian, this Elenin, this just means the constellation of Leo. Finally, the Geminids of mid-December, max December 13 and 14, climax the year with the strongest dependable and observable display. Geminid rates usually pass 60 to 70 an hour at maximum. Concurrent activity from Leo and Canis Minor is also notable during the Geminids. Finally, The oft-overlooked Ursids complete the year's activity, reaching maximum on December 22nd and 23rd. Nearly half the year's visible meteor activity is crammed into two-month interval just described. And if you have any photographs or videos, you can send them to the American Meteor Society. It says up here, report a fireball. That way they can build up their data and share the information with the world. All right, just wanted to put that out there. Since we're all going to be looking up, it appears that we'll have a lot to look at. All righty. God bless.